and Mitch Daniels.
All right, so we are joined by, we have a very special guest with us today, Purdue President Mitch Daniels. Now, this is not the first time we have done this. We got to do this back in this spring, and it was an awesome night. We're so thankful to have you back again on this historic night in our country's history. So thank you so much for coming out tonight. Yes, absolutely. So we did this a few months ago. Since then, we've had a lot of meetings. Now have candidates, they've run their campaigns, they've debated. So my question for you is, what has happened since our first interview? And these campaigns have seemed to, many would say, spiral out of control. How would you characterize what has happened in the campaigns politically since that Super Tuesday event that we had?
Edifying or positive experience for most American citizens.
So this past Friday, I went out to Washington and I got to have an interview with Brian Lamb, sit down one-on-one with the founder of CCN, of course, the namesake of our communication school. It was an incredible opportunity to meet him and to have that opportunity. So my question, I asked him during that day, is this the most divided election that this country's ever experienced, and if he's ever experienced? And he said no, but he said it's definitely something that in his lifetime he's never seen anything quite like that. Would you say that this is possibly the most divided, polarizing election that this country's ever seen?
Well, let's say something. If you take an honest look at history, we've had nastiness in politics before. We've had slander and untruths in politics before. It ain't beanbag, as the old saying goes. But I can't but believe this is really one of the worst examples. And I do believe that we have seen, this is demonstrable, a growing polarization of the American people. And this election, unfortunately, has encouraged that. One would have hoped that in a country in which people have increasingly decided not only that the other half of America is wrong, but must be bad people to hold those people, one would have hoped for candidates who tried to bridge that, tried to hold out a more of a hand to the other side, try to offer programs maybe that would draw people together. That wasn't the choice of either of the campaigns as I see it. That's too bad. Number one, it will maybe further this division, and just maybe more important, make it very hard to get anything done.
Absolutely. So one heavy point on this campaign has been education. And since we are a public university, we can't turn a blind eye to that. Since you've taken this role and you've made the transition from public policy into education, and you've enacted many great policies to save students money to truly make it a welcoming environment here at this university, how can we take the successes that we've had here in West Lafayette and translate them across the country for other universities to see what we're doing here at Purdue and for them to reap from the positive benefits of these experiences?
Trevor, I've always been bashful about prescribing or preaching to anybody else that anything we're doing here at Purdue is necessarily for them. I think every school has to make its own decisions. I will say that in this campaign, there were a lot of extravagant promises made, free this and free that. Nothing's ever free. The only question is who gets the bill. And for many of those suggestions, which I don't think we're going to ever see happen, but if they did, the bill would be in the short term to the same taxpayers who are paying for other things now, and in the long term to the very young people that are supposed to help as we accumulate more debt do these things. So I guess I, without for preaching that we have any answers that anyone else necessarily should borrow from, I would say that it would be helpful if the whole system concentrated, thought about this from the student's end more actively, concentrated on keeping the cost down in the first place, then no one would have to either borrow or subsidize education to the extent that's now necessary.
Absolutely. Have you, in your youth, what was it that really brought you into love of politics and ultimately into your role as a politician? What inspired you? Who inspired you? And what transitioned from you into that role in a professional career?
Like most of my working life, it was pretty accidental. I mean, I did have an interest, and I don't know where it came from. My folks were just good citizens, voters, but never active until maybe much later on after I'd had some activity. So, best answer I can give you is that I became, I had two summer jobs with Boy Mayor of Indianapolis, Richard Lugar, who went on to a great career in the United States Senate. And for me, he, it was such a lucky break because he was such a paradigm of public life. In many ways, the antithesis of what we're seeing and the candidates that we've been looking at this year. Absolute integrity, highest motivations, selfless, he never got rich in public service, and always thinking about the public interest. And so, if you're lucky enough to stumble into the orbit of a person like that early, it wouldn't be surprising that you would pick up some of the spirit. What a noble calling politics can be when it's practiced the right way. And so we need more role models like that. We'll have them again, but I think it's fair to say we didn't have the best of them this year.
Well, I know personally I truly enjoyed the opportunity to have had presidential candidates come through our university over this campaign. I know it's been great to be extended that invitation and really welcomed with open arms anyone who has wanted to come and campaign here at Purdue. How would you say having Bernie Sanders and Gary Johnson come through this campus, how has that impacted the student vote and the students here at Purdue being able to see firsthand those candidates and what they stand for?
Well, I hope it's increased interest. They both got great turnouts for very different messages. But that's what really we ought to be about. I thought it was a great opportunity. I wish the other candidates had come, too. A university and attending one is, for some people, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to see a variety of views, hear opinions they might not otherwise encounter. A lot of people have pointed out that probably a contributing factor to this polarization you asked about is the increasing proclivity of people to narrow their sources of information to things they already agree with. Watch the channels that, or the social media vectors that suit their predispositions. Well, we have a great opportunity at Purdue if we'll continue seizing it to help our students avoid that trap and to encounter, whether they've been to or not, people and viewpoints that are new or different and might provoke them into new ways of thinking. So, sure, as you know, we invited every single one of them, wish they'd all come, and when there's another election, I think we ought to do it again.
Great. That's been an incredible experience. How would you say media, especially in our generation, social media, how has that impacted this campaign? As time has gone on, media continues to evolve, and that's the lamps will lead, that's what we love, and that's what we feed on. How would you say social media in particular has really evolved and changed these candidates, their campaigns, and what they stand for?
Yeah, profoundly. You know, I'm only a few years removed from this endeavor of campaigning. But it's completely different, and it's a fact of life, so it doesn't do any good to complain about it. But I do not see it having enhanced in most ways. I think it's detracted from the political discourse. I mean, 140 characters, candidates spouting little trivialities, little insults at each other. To me, it lowers the level beneath the that's beneath the dignity of the offices these folks are seeking. Now, if it engages more people, if it gets more people in touch and in the flow of the conversation, I see pluses to that. But I think the limitations of social media and the way in which it tends to encourage both trivial or sometimes even degrading expressions is not helpful.
What's been the role of communication in this election with speech writing and debate? How has that really evolved over these past couple of months with the candidates, with their vice presidents, and with their spouses as well?
I can't tell. If anybody's given a really great speech in this campaign, I missed it. Back to your last question, I think right now, at least, the currency of these things is all immediate, 24/7, 140 characters at a time. I guess we shouldn't be looking, for Lincoln's second inaugural or a great profound oratory out of these folks. And it doesn't appear to have been necessary in order to prevail in the primaries or since.
So every 4 years we get this new election day. What excites you year after year?
Hi.
The country yes. starts over every 4 years. What excites you about this day?
Thank you.
I'm excited to have this one over. And I don't think I'm going to win any. No, just state the obvious. For all the defects in the system, for all the misgivings anybody may have about this candidate or that one, in the United States of America, power passes peacefully. And there's always a chance for a fresh start. And we've had presidents either elected or sometimes come to office through the loss of their predecessor. Of whom little was expected, who grew in office or just simply surprised. And so there's always that opportunity. And we've got huge problems in this country, many of which were not, in my view, fairly and openly discussed in this election. But now, somebody tomorrow is going to be president-elect. And it'll be sober up time. The invective and the mud balls and the promises to this group and promises to that group, all that will be behind a person who's going to be faced with the reality of an economy that's not growing fast enough, massive national debts that are getting worse at a terrifying rate, threats around the world that will need to be dealt with, and large numbers of people who are beginning to lose hope in our system. And so let's hope that great set of challenges will summon the very best, first from the winner, but more important, from their administration and from us all.
So we want to open this question up to our audience. They've been tweeting in questions after we've been talking this whole time. We'll get those questions in a second. But my next question for you, when everything is finally resolved, the next few hours, as the states, as we can see here in our live broadcast, as they're coming in, what is next for these candidates? The winner, the loser, what do we want to see attitude-wise, and how would you hope they will handle themselves with the result in a few hours?
One hopes that the winner will be gracious. One hopes that the loser will be gracious and properly respectful. Winston Churchill said, victory magnanimity. And there hadn't been a lot of that on display, but it's been a rough and tumble campaign. Maybe starting tonight, whoever wins, and the runner-up, let's say, they'll certainly have a chance to display that. And I hope, for the country's sake, but also really for the sake of the way we all view them, that they will rise to that. And I'm sure the degree of dignity and nobility, the office they've contending for represents for us all.
How important is it to have things such as this for our young students and young people to engage? This is our world in a couple of years. This is our, we're electing folks that will be here 4-8 years from now when we are well into our careers. How important is it for us to stay in tune and stay in depth to what is going on in our
Yeah, I think it's terrific. Hats off to those who conceived it, the students who did, and those of you who are doing such a great job of implementing it. I mean, this is not spectator sport in the end. These are decisions that will have everything to do with the nation you inherit. And so I'm just very encouraged. I have to say, it's been a dispiriting year in many ways. Americans deserve better than they got. And yeah, here at Purdue, I don't see a lot of discouragement. I see a lot of students who are interested, who are taking in stride the negative parts and looking for the positive. And that may be the best memory I take out of this election.
I want to get to two of our Twitter questions that students have been asking. So, one of our questions, how does Purdue help inform students about voting, considering so many are out of state?
I hope we did a good job. It was on all the screens. In fact, one of our alert faculty members told me yesterday at the gym the screen had the wrong hours on it. I hope at least we were trying to tell people. And we got that corrected. But I hope, after everything we've all been bathing in about this election, if there's anybody who had the remotest interest in voting, I don't think they'd have the excuse that they simply didn't know how or where to go.
We're going to get to talk to our West Lafayette Mafia mayors here right after you. What's the partnership between the university and the city of West Lafayette and the Mafia as we get ready to enter into this huge State Street project that is about to change our neighborhood for the better? What's your partnership with them, and what do you expect next summer?
You know, it couldn't be better, and it shouldn't be taken for granted. You know, the old phrase, town and gown, was coined because usually they're at odds, and they come at things in a different way. And there have been times I'm informed that Purdue and its neighboring communities weren't on the same page and argued about things. Quite the opposite today. Those two mayors are terrific. They're both great. They come from different parties. Doesn't make a difference. They're just both great civic leaders. And the State Street Project, we're not aware of anything like it in America. $120 million, 50-50 deal, which we think will dramatically enhance the environment of the campus and of the community and the attractiveness of the greater community to do business, citizens, in our case, of course, faculty and students. So we've all got a lot riding on it, and it is a big and ambitious program. But we didn't have people like that in local leadership, and we didn't have a really tight symbiotic relationship that we could never attempt to.
So people have said that our generation is the most vocal when it comes to politics. We love to express our opinion, which every American has the right to do and every American should do. But it's also noted that our generation, college students, have low turnout in polls. So one of our questions on Twitter was, what is one thing that we can do to help fix America's voter turnout problem, specifically college students?
Well, that's a hard question. It's not new. You know, young people have a lot of other things on their plate, a lot of other things on their mind. Some of the issues someone like me might think are very immediate might seem a little distant. So I wouldn't be too hard on the fact that, again, this year, turnout may be somewhat lower. I have to say, honestly, that I can understand why a lot of students, at least looking at the national election this year, might not find a lot to draw them out, take time away from other pursuits. But again, I think the things we discussed earlier, Trevor, the best thing I know a university can do is is provide as rich a conversation as many interesting guests and programs and seminars and expose young people to the range of their choices, to the urgency of some of the issues they may not have thought too much about that are, you are going to wind up living with, feeling with.
My final question for you today, I think this is something that everyone's kind of looking at in the final few hours. What would you say to a Purdue student who's unhappy with the results tonight? Their party, their candidate was not elected. What would you say to students to do individually that they could do to help fix that for the future instead of maybe turning into another method of frustration?
Well, I think the obvious starting point is to assess why the candidate lost and what was missing. What could have been done better? What could have been said better? Then look to associate. If you're not going to be a candidate yourself, maybe it's a little earlier for that, you know, for some of our students, but look for somebody who the next time might try to convey the message you think is important in a more successful, which to me probably means something more unifying fashion. I really think there will be a very interesting regardless of the outcome. There will be a lot of soul searching on one side or the other, possibly on both, after the election is difficult and contentious as this one. That's a great thing for young people to participate in. Every young person in America, I believe, has a very legitimate reason to say to their elders, you haven't been taking care of business very well. You have not created the opportunity, the climate, the economy, the fiscal future, and the spirit. Stacked up a lot of bills you're about to get. We're entitled to have a say, maybe louder say than before in how we go forward.
So for the rest of the night, are you going to hang around here, go home, watch the election? What are your plans for the rest of the night?
I've got some homework. And yeah. I'll probably do it.
Yes.
When the TV is on, my place usually it's muted.
Yeah.
And I can go watch the ball game. In this case, it's a different ball game. I'll probably watch this ball game
just for the graphics.
Again, I just want to say, Trevor, you and everybody can put this together. This is a great initiative. I hope you do it every election year and pass this down to other students. I can't believe that there are too many places in America, too many campuses in America where anything better is going on.
Thank you so much. Could you give President Daniels a round of applause for being here this evening? We're going to send it over to Sarah Cohen right now to continue our election night coverage.
It's a great atmosphere here tonight in the Grand Hall at Purdue Honors College and Residence. And we hope you've been enjoying your time with us so far. We still have a lot more time coming up in this election. Students, if you're on campus, come stop by the Honors College and share your thoughts and opinions about this election with us. Or you can contact us by using hashtag PurdueVotes on Facebook and Twitter. It's now 6:45 and we still have a lot more elections and results to go in the Midwest. Stay tuned on more to come with this election live at Purdue University. Now, Molly Shaughnessy will speak to our two mayors joining with us today. Over to you, Molly.